We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back, friends. Second hour underway here on Truth Warrior. You're listening to TruthFrequencyRadio.com. And I'm here, David Whitehead, coming at you from Toronto, Canada. And in the second hour, we're going to be bringing on Tom Clearwater. And for those of you who are not familiar with Tom, I'm not surprised. He is new on the scene, and I highly recommend you checking out the recent interview that he did with Alfred Weber. You can get that on YouTube. Just type in his name. The interview is there. It's the first interview that he's done, kind of just voicing his opinion, but he has been researching behind the scenes and supporting many people and helping out with various things like the disclosure movement and working with Stephen Bassett and many others, and just trying to help enlighten humanity and help to contribute at this time. And we like to see that, and really appreciate people that will come forward and speak their mind and share their truth. And that's what this show is about, and that's why I'm very honored to be able to have Tom join me. I'll give you a little background on Tom. He's born and raised in Saskatchewan, so that was my stomping ground growing up. So I'm very familiar with that territory. And from early years, he showed broad interest in most everything he came across. And those interests eventually showed themselves as falling into two broad streams, religion and spirituality on the one hand, and physics and psychology on the other. And the collection of interests he entertained throughout his life defined the broad polarity of physics and metaphysics, or relative absolute. Educationally, he attended a theological college for 3 years, then took a BA in general arts, then an MA in ancient and culture, and he followed a degree in law, where he graduated with a great distinction. And Tom has practiced as a lawyer, worked in, and his broad interest in things, in all things human, have led Tom to formulate a new human architecture based on non-linear principles of polarity, scalar humanity. So we're going to be getting into some fascinating roads with Tom tonight. I recently had a discussion with him, and I will just say that my mind was definitely expanded by discussing the various points with him. So it's my pleasure to bring him to you tonight for the first time on Truth Warrior. So Tom, thanks for joining me, and welcome to the show, my friend.
Hello, David. Grew up in Saskatchewan, did you? Nice to be on your show. Nice to hear your voice again.
Oh, great. No, great to have you. And yeah, I spent some time in Yorkton, Saskatchewan,
right,
from 94. And then in Regina, I spent a little bit of time as well. And we had, in our last tour, we actually visited Regina. So we got to drive through the prairies again. And it's been a while. Other than that, I haven't really visited. My parents are still there. But it's great to have a fellow Canadian and fellow Saskatchewanite on the show.
Right. And for those who don't know, Saskatchewan is a prairie province in Canada here, and you'll find at best about 1 million people there. It's very sparsely populated. Grain growing kind of a materials and mining kind of province, basically.
Oh, yeah. And it's maybe not the most exciting to drive through, but let's just say it is the land of the skies. And I grew up watching the Aurora Borealis, you know, swinging out on the – we'd go to the schoolyard and hit up the swings and just stare at the sky. It's one of the biggest skies you'll see because there's nothing really blocking your view. I miss seeing that greatly, I must say.
Yes, it's beautiful.
Well, welcome, Tom, and I'm really glad to be able to have you here. We only have an hour, but I just wanted to kind of do an introductory interview with you, and then we can hopefully do some follow-ups, because I know you have a lot of very fascinating information to share. And if you wouldn't mind, I mean, I gave a little bit of your background there, but what was it that brought you into studying these, I guess what would be deemed alternative or fringe subject matters, or getting into the idea of scalar technology and whatnot? And then, you know, eventually coming to the point where you were actually going to be speaking about it. What was it that sort of opened up your mind to these different concepts?
Right. Well, you know, anybody who, with any sort of diligence, tries to understand what this earth is about, will eventually run into limits in terms of what is available in let's say, consensus or popularly scripted sources. And in my desire, really long time desire to make sense of my life, which, you know, it didn't really make sense from the outset. There was always this feeling of that there was just something I couldn't quite put my finger on about things here that didn't add up. And in my attempt to come to understanding, I eventually and you know, maybe about half of the way through, started hitting up against those limits of you know, what is generally considered this, you know, life on this planet, the social processes, the institutional realities and relations of people. I hit those limits and necessarily then went beyond them. I think that's a fairly common experience for people who are, you know, truly wanting to solve the dissonance, essentially, that kind of sits in the backdrop of life at large here on this planet.
It's interesting, your background as well, I must say, because you've worked in many of those different sectors. You've worked in law, you've been to the universities, you've worked in government, you've worked in business. So you've been around and kind of, I guess, been able to experience the various levels of how this, you know, society is structured, how the different institutions are structured. And then now, as you're saying, you come to a point where things need to be looked at in a different way, and we have new information coming out now. And, you know, what was it that really pushed you into looking into the deeper side of this? You know, if you go from just sort of topically glancing at some of the material that I know you cover, how did you think of getting into the deep end of the pool, so to speak?
Well, the deep end, yeah, that's, you know, I was kind of, let's say, several years ago, early interested in crop circles. Couldn't really make sense of them, because they certainly didn't seem to be produced by any sort of technology that I knew about, or that was at least publicly talked about. And once I started investigating, just through that, you know, that small crack in the kind of like the system understanding, the conventional system understanding, eventually I found myself down a rabbit hole. And it was a rabbit hole that actually really started making sense of things that had bothered me all my life, but things I couldn't really give a name to or put a voice to, short of, you know, doing what I did, was to dive down that rabbit hole and begin exploring matters that are off planet, larger than, you know, the typical kind of cosmologies presented in common discourse in universities and whatever else. And you're right, I have had experience in a lot of the institutions here, at least in Canada, and at a very high level. Like, most of my work was either could be categorized as very high or at the very highest level of the institutions in which I worked. And I never, you know, working in those places didn't solve those questions for me. So that was an interesting part of the backdrop that informed my wanting, you know, to take a look outside the institutional realities that I had experienced from the inside.
And that's an interesting thing, because, you know, so many people these days, you think of the kids going through the school system and just the way our you know, there's that pressure to go out, get that job, work your way up, climb the greasy pole to the top, step on everybody you possibly can in order to get there, and, you know, keep supporting this system that ultimately has been holding, you know, it's just not been moving forward. It's been almost helping to devolve the human experience. And so for you to look in that and work in those fields and get that experience, and then still have that thought in your mind that there was something more to life, there was another layer that you were driven to get into, I think that that's exceptional. And it's very few and far between that people, especially when they make it to the higher levels, would actually branch out and look into.
Well, I was always dedicated to what I felt was true. And really, it's kind of a devotional leaning that I have. It's almost like a bhakta orientation I have inside myself, that if I came across something that was true, I went with it. I refused to compromise my own internal integrity for the sake of, you know, whether it was career advancement or whatever, you know, you might want to, as something outside myself that I would, you know, be compromising for. And, you know, in terms of those lofty heights of working in the corporate, commercial, and legal worlds, it's, you know, when I was a first-year lawyer back working in, you know, one of the top firms in Canada, I wrote a paper on derivatives taxation. This is back in the 1990s. And that actually became the paper which was referenced in a couple of Supreme Court of Canada cases that actually define the law of derivatives in Canada. Now, the derivatives are very complex. They're kind of mathematical creatures of contract that basically define risk on a what is essentially a gambling basis. And there I was as a first-year student having kind of, you know, sitting in this large tower working with, you know, all of these very wealthy and high-paying clients, sitting at the top of the field of taxation law in my first year. And there was nothing but kind of like a road down from there. It was like at the peak of the mountain, I realized that, okay, that's I can see my future here. And so from that vantage point, I was able then to gain a kind of context on what is offered in, let's say, the job or career world that I could double check within myself to see, well, does that really satisfy? And because I was sitting at that peak, I didn't have to look any higher to question, oh, well, maybe there's just something beyond this little, you know, venue to provide me a little bit more, et cetera. No. And so what I, with the orientation I had, I then made a concerted effort to apply myself in a way that would bring a level of coherence inside myself. And I always felt that that kind of activity would bring not only a kind of satisfaction and happiness that I wanted, but it would also take care of, you know, any material difficulties that might otherwise be experienced along the way. Money follows what you love, in fact, is my motto for myself.
Well, that's just very interesting, and I appreciate that, Tom. And so let's, I mean, just because we only have a little bit of time here tonight, I want to start unpacking this concept of scalar humanity, as you call it. And if we use that word scalar, maybe we could start with what people might be familiar with in regards to that term. Now, there might be people listening who've never heard of that, and they're like, scalar, what are you talking about? But we're talking about, you know, obviously most people have heard of it in terms of weaponry, you know, scalar-based weaponry or scalar-based technology. Perhaps we could start with a bit of a definition, and then we can segue into this concept of scalar humanity.
Right, sure. Well, let's begin with Tesla, because Tesla was something of the grandfather of what we now have come to understand as scalar electromagnetics. And I'll confine the conversation in this part of it to electromagnetics. Tesla discovered that there was some configuration of energy, and I'll just put it in those general terms, went beyond typical electromagnetics that were being formulated within his day into, seemed to exist rather outside the normal channel of understanding that was, that people had absorbed for themselves back then. And Tesla being, you know, more of an experimental scientist and not a theoretician, he didn't essentially theorize or put into words what he, you know, really felt this other realm was, but it was a realm that was, you could say, constitutional of what we see and experience as the material plane. So that, for instance, let's say a Tesla effect, which, you know, can otherwise be called a scalar effect or a nonlinear electromagnetic effect, it could be called an etheric effect, referencing the so-called ether. It could be called a zero-point field effect. There's all sorts of kind of namings of this reality. Resides in some fashion as everything you see, not separate from anything you see, but constitutional to everything you see. So, for instance, what Tesla learned is that you could constitute and deconstitute matter through these nonlinear electromagnetic means. You could essentially escape the limitations of the physical, so-called physical material world and its entropic, you know, its entropy-based forms of friction and inertia and momentum, et cetera. You could escape all of that through a kind of what has, you know, loosely been called an anti-gravitic or an electrogravitic form of propulsion, leading to, of course, you know, a spacecraft propulsion and whatnot. All these effects resided at the level of the constitutional basis of matter itself, and Tesla was the guy who basically discovered how to access it.
So, and this is, of course, going back. I mean, he's looking into this back early 1900s, and in the mainstream fields of as we've evolved in our civilization since then, mm-hmm. we haven't really heard much about this kind of continuative research into this technology, although I'm sure it's been conducted behind the scenes and we know a little bit about it. Mm-hmm. In your opinion, what happened to Tesla and this whole field of research?
Right, and I'll answer that question. Then I'll get back to kind of the stream of what we were talking there. In the 1950s, you could read reports in various trade journals and magazines and whatnot that that reported on progress on anti-gravity technologies. And suddenly in 1952, it was a very particular date, it was either 52 or 53, the entire field went black. And before then, you could read about, you know, such people as, you know, Tesla, Townsend, Brown, various people like this who were kind of pioneer experimenters who had stumbled onto these curious effects that, you know, when they pursued them, kind of opened up an entirely different universe. So I think what happened in the 1950s was that the powers that be, whoever they may be, and we can talk about that at some time, but the powers that be realized that, amongst other things, you know, there's a very complex kind of multifactorial realization, I think, but among other things, what they realized is that this new powerful kind of material constitutional electromagnetics was so incredibly powerful that, And not only powerful, but it could also be replicated relatively easily. Like, you don't have to be building something at the, you know, using quantum science to, in order to replicate some of these effects. For instance, someone like John Hutchison just, you know, did it out of, you know, putting together some electromagnetics. But because the destructive effects are so enormous, I think a decision was made to basically suppress not only the technology, but the knowledge of the fact that the technology could exist. In other words, the knowledge of basically what could be called open system scientific inquiry. So all of it was suppressed. And for other reasons, of course, but including the reason, I think, that if it weren't suppressed, there are enough people on the planet who could possibly get their hands on and design nonlinear electromagnetic devices that could, you know, basically create any sort of havoc you could imagine. So I think a decision was made that for safety, purposes of safety within the species, until such time as there are means in place to deal with people who might intend to use these devices in destructive ways, and the human population was itself more evolved. Until that time, then nobody would hear about it. And I think that's what happened personally.
That's very interesting. But, so like, if we get back to the concept of what this is and what we're dealing right. with here and the evolution of this, so what would be, I guess, you know, we're talking scalar, electromagnetic, these effects and whatnot. Where did it kind of go from there, you think?
Well, let's go back to, and I'll draw an analogy to, you know, the human architecture, which I've called scalar humanity. If you look at kind of like one of the primary devices that Tesla used, what is called a Tesla coil. It's a very simple electromagnetic device. Basically, a Tesla coil has two aspects to the circuitry. One aspect, which is the power input aspect, is a closed circuit. It's a regular, typical electromagnetic circuit, in a sense. You know, it has a power supply. That power supply basically drains through a transformer into ground and then needs to be reconstituted again as an input of power. This is typically how any sort of regular electromagnetics works. The transformer that this closed system aspect of the circuit runs through and operates through on is what is called the secondary side of that transformer. And the transformer always has, you know, two sides. One's the primary, one's the secondary. On the secondary side, what you have is a configuration, an electronic configuration, which is open system. It's an open circuit, essentially. So essentially, you have a capacitor and an inductor on the secondary side of this Tesla coil. But the important point here is that it is an open system design. So in essence, a Tesla coil is the combination of a closed system plus an open system. And you can see in that there's a it's kind of reaching into a fundamental polarity there, whereby on the closed side it provides a kind of energy and vibratory signature, which then on the open side can be transmitted non-locally to create any or all of these non-linear electromagnetic effects. So it was what Tesla's genius was to combine closed and open architectures within the same device to create the kinds of effects that he discovered. Now, if you look at a human being, and this is what I discovered when I was researching all these matters, a human being essentially corresponds to this architecture that I've described for a Tesla coil. Essentially, we have within the human being, we have the heart circulatory system. And that system is of course, a closed system. And through the pulsing of the heart, which is an electromagnetic pulsing, it creates a kind of a frequency signature, which is essentially the frequency signature of who you are. It is that detailed and contains, you know, that kind of subjective information. That closed heart regulatory system can be is analogous to the primary aspect of the Tesla coil circuit. In my understanding, this heart circulatory system interfaces inside ourselves with a fundamental polarity of what I've come to understand as the head brain and the gut brain, which are connected by very strong nerve centers running up your spine. Now, the head and gut, many people probably don't know, but when you are developing as a fetus in your mother's womb, the head actually splits off from a larger neuronal mass, then floats up and becomes the head. The other part, which is the other half of that neuronal mass, it floats down and becomes your intestine. Now, the intestine is a coiled unit. It's very, very different from the brain, from the head brain. But both are brains. Both are made of neuronal circuitry. But they are fundamentally opposite in their configuration, so that you have this, again, this fundamental polarizing going on within the brain-gut system, which, in my understanding, and relating this back to a Tesla coil, corresponds analogously to the secondary open circuit system of the Tesla coil. So it kind of struck me that wow, you know, the human architecture is this closed open architecture, and you know, by open system, I mean, you know, and these realities are becoming more demonstrated and documented as time goes on. But we have, you know, many so-called paranormal effects where people, you know, they hear something, they see something internally, they get ideas and visions they can't explain as coming from without, et cetera, et cetera. So we seem to be tapped into the rest of the universe by some means. And I think in my discoveries of, you know, applying, let's say, this Tesla coil analogy to the human architecture, I think I've discovered basically how all that works in its most general terms.
Wow, that's really, really interesting. And it's very interesting to me because I've looked at the architecture of the human body, even from, say, like an esoteric point of view, coming back from maybe something like the Hermetic or Gnostic traditions, or some of the even the indigenous or Aboriginal cultures, the way they describe, you know, the human body and what its functions are. And you get into the writings of, or the, like, you know, Adam Kadmon, and looking at the measurements and the sacred geometry. And so when you're bringing this into a modern scientific concept and relating it also to, you know, free energy and what Tesla was tapping into, I think that's absolutely mind-blowing. But Tom, let's take a little break here. This is the perfect place to split it up, and let's continue this on the other side. We got another segment here, ladies and gentlemen, with Tom Clearwater. And welcome back, folks. Our number two, final segment of the show on my new time slot here on Truth Frequency Radio. I must say I'm feeling quite comfortable. And so don't forget to tune in every Sunday, 2 p.m. Pacific, 5 p.m. Eastern. And I'm speaking to my good friend Tom. He's joined us, and he is also a fellow Canadian. And we're talking about the idea of free energy, Tesla, and what we are as human beings. The fact that, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Tom, but are we in fact free energy devices, is what you're saying, in a way?
That's absolutely what we are. Yes. You know, let's really simplify what I've been saying here, and simplify what was Tesla's actual discovery. What Tesla discovered was the reality of an open system universe. So closed system electromagnetics, that had been around for some while now. Everybody, you know, in Tesla's day was familiar with it, and anybody, you know, playing with electronics was familiar with closed system electromagnetics. Well, Tesla discovered that there is an open universe that is the kind of like constitutional basis of what we see as the kind of conceptually closed physicality that we exist in. So that you could say that Tesla brought the understanding of the practical understanding of infinity into our practical kind of physical understanding. So if you, for instance, ask, okay, what is the meaning of openness? Openness means there is no boundary. It's boundaryless. There's no end at the point at which openness stops. Openness is openness. So it's undefined and infinite. And so what I have discovered is that the human architecture is configured in such a way that, yes, we have both kind of closed, kind of local causal relations that you can see. You know, if you step onto a street and you step in front of an automobile, there's going to be consequences. And that's kind of basically consequences of a Newtonian or closed system or local causal fashion. We also have this side to ourselves that basically opens into the rest of the universe, is in fact non-locally connected to the rest of the universe. And in that non-local connectedness, you choose your description, we step into a holographic reality. We step into a place where there is no place, there is no distance, no separation. We step into a place that is infinite, in the sense that there is no boundary to this place. So, of course, you know, free energy, yeah, of course, right. That's a necessary implication of what Tesla discovered.
And then that just begs the question about, you know, if that's what we are, what is our purpose then? If our purpose is not just to, as we were talking about earlier, go to work, work a job, pay taxes, and live a life of, just a more material sense, maybe that'd be like the closed system part of us. But you know, is there a greater purpose to the human race?
Right. Yeah. No. That's an awesome question, and that's a question I've spent a lot of time trying to understand for my own purposes. And basically, what I've come to in my own understanding to this point, and could change in the future by degrees, or maybe, you know, in its entirety, I don't know. But what I understand is that on planet Earth here, planet Earth is a severe environment. I mean, wow, it's, you know, basically the niggle that I had to solve in my life, you know, that question that sat in the back, the dissonance I felt, was essentially the dissonance of thinking that I'm living in a closed system universe. And once I started understanding that, no, this reality is not closed, it's open also, I started looking, you know, off planet, and I started looking inwardly in terms of, you know, looking to non-local holographic realities inside myself. And of course, then the question comes up, well, why do we on this planet so strangely subsist in this kind of closed circuit falsity? Because it is a falsity. There is no such thing, in fact, as a closed system, as a purely closed system. But if you look at the you know, the various kinds of cosmologies that have been propagated over the centuries, those are essentially cosmologies that say, let's say in the scientific vein, you know, the Big Bang universe. The Big Bang universe is a closed system idea. It essentially says that there was an initial input of, call it energy, at the beginning of the universe. That energy then, you know, exploded in some mysterious fashion and started expanding. But every event and every interaction after that initial event of the Big Bang, every subsequent event is basically parts of the universe scrambling for what is essentially a limited amount of goods and resources. And this is exactly what your previous guest was describing, that any closed system is a system of scarcity. And so you can see it. It's like it's a me versus you mentality, where win-lose, where if one person in anywhere wins, there must be one person who loses, because the net sum has to add up to the original amount of energy inputted to the system. And in fact, that amount of energy, due to the so-called law of, you know, the second law, law of thermodynamics, becomes in ever scarcer supply over time, and the universe basically dies in a heat death, where there is, you know, essentially a every place is the same temperature, so no further work can be done in that system. That's all false, by implication of what Tesla discovered. So we're going to have to come up with entirely new theories about, you know, how this universe has come about. In fact, it cannot have come about through simply a closed system understanding that is incoherent with basic discoveries from Tesla. But in any event, coming back to this question of this planet, you know, we begin on this planet in essentially a closed system mindset, and we grow through that and grow from closed into an understanding that, whoa, it's open too. There's an entirely different universe out there, et cetera, et cetera. I asked myself, why does it begin closed like that? And what could possibly be the purpose of an entire planet, or perhaps even an entire dimension, call it the 3D dimension, existing in this closed only hallucination, is essentially what it is. Well, my understanding is that it is within that state that people are essentially forced to decide who they are, what their values are, in reference to nothing outside themselves. Because again, there is no outside themselves in that sense, because it's been closed off. There's a limit that you can that you cannot go beyond in terms of trying to find some opening into some other realm. So all you have is what we have here in that, you know, so-called hallucination. But being within that, people really believe it to be true. What happens functionally, in my opinion, is that people learn to essentially trust themselves. That is essentially the only kind of endpoint that can be reached that has any form of stability about it, whereby in that process, people essentially individuate. They individuate from a group level down into an individual level of self-identity. So that's a bit of a longer conversation that, you know, we could entertain. I'm not sure how much time we have to entertain it here, but essentially my understanding is that the reason why we develop painfully through this closed system hallucination that basically is our birthright for coming into this planet is to find out who we are on an individual level, because there's no group out there that is going to save your ass when push comes to shove in this kind of scarcity closed system mindset. It doesn't work. You know, basically everybody is having to fend for themselves, and in that, you know, virtual panic is what it is. People have to learn a new basis other than relying on anything outside themselves. And in finding that new basis, they can come and only can come to rely on themselves as the fundamental providers of everything they need, which is, of course, to arrive at the point of realizing, wow, I am not just this skin encapsulated person, this closed off little isolated separated person. I am as large as the entire universe, and that entire universe being infinite, I don't have to depend on anything outside myself to provide myself for whatever I could want or need. Now that's a little ways in the future, I realize, but the implication of what I'm spelling out here is that is the direction we are heading, to a place where people are self-generative, which is the essence of, you know, an infinite open system universe.
So essentially it's a maturing process.
Yes.
And in another sense, it's as if, you know, Earth is, it's like, you know, it's Earth's school. It's the school of hard knocks. It's the place, it's a place to learn. And I believe we can make it whatever we want to, provided that there is a critical mass of awareness of where we can go and what the potential can be. But also, as you're pointing out, there is valuable lessons to be learned when we're in this sort of, you know, kind of quarantine situation. It's as if we're kind of playing a game of survivor here. And the goal isn't just to win a game, but it's to gain the experience necessary so that we can evolve on maybe that more open system level, right?
Well, I believe that to be true. And you know, my experience of ET reality, so far as any information I have accessed, suggests that you know, pushing this, what I have called this level of self-identity down to the individual level, is really a binary change for the universe. It's ETs, so far as I understand, basically all exist in some form of group mentality. Let's say the Greys, who are, you know, evidently a hive mind. But basically any other ET culture that I have read about or trusted the source of reading, et cetera, looks to me to be based on a group-based identity. So that the Earth experiment then reveals itself, in my opinion, as an experiment to push the level of self-identity down to the individual, which would mean giving the individual actual creative power.
As I'm thinking here, it's as if you can't function in a unit with other people or work harmoniously with others unless you fully become an individual recognized, I guess, unless you've done that. Like, it's as if,
yes,
I look at it like a family, right? If you have all kinds of chaos and arguing and fighting and constant, you know, all this stuff going on in your family that's very negative, it's usually because people are putting too much on one person, or there's assumptions that are made. There's all these little miscommunications that take place. They're not individually developed enough or mature enough to be able to have a harmonious relationship as a family. Is that kind of the idea there, maybe?
Well, that's precisely what I'm saying, is that, you know, people get into conflict. If you look at the structure of personal conflict, what they're conflicting over is some notion that, you know, you have something that I need, and I need to fight in order for you to give that to me. Now, that would be, in essence, if you have something I need, that would be, in essence, a group identity. But that group identification doesn't work on this planet. This planet doesn't, you know, allow that. The actual lines of energy, if you kind of look at the way things go on this planet, you have to rely on your own footing for being who you are, and you have to know who you are. Those two are the same, such that once you come into your full self-knowing and be yourself fully, then you're not going to demand from other people. It's, you're going to hit a generative point. You're going to basically become a generative person who can give and with discernment and with a freedom that is otherwise unavailable.
Yeah, it's that, it's like we're saying, it's that developmental process that must take place in order to get to that point. I mean, where do you think we stand here when we see we're in this time of change and we're in this time of political and social and economic upheaval? It seems like everything is coming to a head. It's as if all of these ancient predictions and prophecies, we're talking about cycles and ending, you know, yugas and all this stuff, and we're in sort of this age of transition. Is that a sign that we're on the cusp of moving further towards that realization of who and what we are, and you know, or is it a sign that we're devolving further, a bit of both? What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think we're evolving, and I think we're approaching basically a bifurcation point where we are going to see a leap into a nonlinear status in some respects within society. I don't know if your listeners have seen any videos where, you know, someone, let's say, pours a little bit of sand onto a vibrating plate, vibrates it with a certain frequency, and you'll see a certain pattern appear in the sand on that plate.
We're talking about cymatics, basically.
That's cymatics. Now, if you increase the frequency, eventually what will happen is that the pattern on the plate will eventually start getting a little fuzzy-edged, and then very rapidly it'll go into a chaos node, and then very rapidly after that, it will form a new, more subtle, more complex pattern. Hmm. Now, that's what I feel is happening in society, and I sense that it is happening by means of a kind of fundamental polarization going on within society. So that, you know, you've got the various camps who are opposed in interest to each other, essentially going to, you know, ever further extremes in trying to not only defend their own little camp, their own pole, but to increase the reach of it and the influence of it. Now, that process, for its part, you could map it as a prisoner's dilemma, essentially, where, you know, let's say back in history when Russia and the United States were in an arms race, it became patently clear at some point that in that polarizing, that intensification of these two geopolitical realities called Russia and the United States, and they're building all these nuclear weapons. Eventually, there came a realization that, well, if either of us throws off a weapon, everybody is dead. Mutual assured destruction. In that state of absolute polarization, it's to people. I've experienced my own life. Nonlinear happens within society such that nobody pushed the button back then because they all realized it was pushing the button on their own death.
Sorry, Tom, you're kind of breaking up there a little bit. Let me see if I can just adjust something here. There we go. Okay, test one, two. We're good to go. Okay, sorry about that, Tom. You kind of broke up the thought there.
All right, so just let me summarize what I was saying. That if you look at the way a cell divides, what happens is that the chromosomes in a cell will split and divide off from each other. And they will go essentially travel to the outside wall of the cell in what is called a polarized state. And once they have reached the furthest reach of that polarization, certain processes are triggered in the cell such that the cell divides. And it becomes, in the divided fashion, the same cell. It's the same single cell, but it's now divided into two and existing as two cells. In other words, existing as a more complex pattern than what the, you know, the single cell was. And that's what I see happening in society, that the various factions of the entire power grid of society are polarizing in such a way that we are very quickly approaching a nonlinear leap in society, which is really good news.
Yeah, that's a very interesting thought. And you and I discussed this a little bit when we had our talk the other day. And I think this is very, very interesting. You know, we've obviously, on this show, we've covered a lot of information about history and sort of how a lot of these different power structures became to be developed. We've discussed the idea of, you know, various political conspiracies and cover-ups and, you know, with certain groups of megalomaniacal people getting to the top of the food chain and then directing the ship down a path that is not in the best interest of the human race, but is in their best interest. Of course, we've seen this throughout history, and it's just – but now it seems that there is this awakening taking place. Would it be safe to say that this is also taking place in some of the highest levels, like in the levels of government, in the levels of finance and banking and media, even though it's not necessarily coming out publicly? And most people cringe when they think of those associations. But it's got to be happening on every level if this is something that is taking place on a deeper level than just, you know, the physical. This is something deeper. And so are we seeing this happen at the top levels? And is there division, as you're saying, amongst the decision makers? Are there people breaking away from this old world order, this idea of how to keep people under control and how to direct the ship in this way? And then people that are trying to think outside the box, and they're like, no, we need to move forward in a more progressive way. And, you know, people are ready. Do you see that this is kind of what's going on here?
Yeah, I think that's true, David. You know, it's easy to be worried about things going badly. And there's lots in the world that you can point to suggest that there's an intensification of negative factors out there. I see that. That's totally true. It's sometimes a little difficult to remind oneself that there is also an intensification of good factors, positive factors.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, we, for instance, having, let's say, the internet, we have a kind of informational capability that, you know, at least in so far as recorded history is concerned, we've never had. And you know, what happened to the planet when the printing press was developed? Well, we've got that in spades here with the development of the internet in terms of people coming to better understanding of what anything is, what the power structure is, what, you know, people are doing behind closed doors, what industries are doing to kind of further their empire interests that aren't in the, you know, the interests of the people they're supposedly serving. All of that is coming out through this one little channel called the internet. And that's just one thing that is good. You know, you look at longevity. Longevity has increased dramatically in the last 100 years for most of the people on this planet. It's a tremendous benefit. We have stability. We have utilities. You know, goodness sakes, people take for granted that they've got running water, let alone hot water.
Yeah, if you're having a hot shower and a cup of coffee in the morning, you're already well ahead of people in the past, and also a lot of the people still alive on the planet living in third world countries, et cetera.
Yeah, that's right. So anyway, so what I see is an intensification of both, let's say, positive and negative. And what happens when the state is reached where, let's say, the negative wants to reach any further to grab more for itself, which you see a lot of out there, they're going to realize that one further reach into that cookie jar is going to cause the collapse of the entire system. And then it's back to the caves we go. So with that realization, you know, people are going, well, you know, I do like my Lamborghini, but, you know, I want it, you know, I want roads available and gasoline available to be able to drive it.
Yeah.
So I think there's a profound realization happening, and I think things are, you know, just to give, let's say, your listeners a little heads up in terms of my navigation in this world, when I see things getting worse, I see them as getting better. Things getting worse is a product of kind of like the further intensification of these polarized realities. And yes, I do believe they are polarized right up to the top.
I really hate to cut you off, Tom. Mm. We got to continue this discussion in a further show. The time has run short, but I just want to thank you so much. I think your work is incredibly fascinating. And actually, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to be featuring Tom on the Modern Knowledge Tour coming up in August. So look forward to that. More announcements to come regarding that. You can get everything at modernknowledge.ca. Thanks again for joining me, Tom.
Thank you.